chilly morning. That whole summer was a lot longer than normal. It's done for sure, I think. Ooh, look at nice sun. 9 a.m. meeting.
Sarah. Hey Scott, how you doing?
Good, how are you?
Good.
Man.
How's it going,
man? How you doing, brother? That was fun. Sometimes I have meetings for business purposes, for the intent of trying to get business. Other times I just have meetings because I just like seeing people and hanging out. George's one of those guys. Awesome guy. And that was just to have some coffee and chat. We're both tech nerds, so we have good conversations. Well, I am back and getting to work on the next wedding. Right now, it's that tough spot. I've talked about this before, but there's like a few different projects that I'm working on simultaneously. Because some of them, because of timeline, when they need to be done. Others because of rush edits, depending on what the project is. And it's a tough situation to be in because my mind is kind of in like three different spots where I kind of go and do pieces of one and I jump to the other. And it's really hard from a creative standpoint. So I'm just trying to process that a little bit. Sometimes it's fun to go between projects because your brain stays energized and on top of it. Other times it's really hard to stay focused on one thing. So I'm going to work on this wedding for a few hours and then I'm going to work on something else the next couple hours. But all you'll see is just this. And you may be asking yourself, didn't just yesterday you said, I don't know if I can ever use Premiere anymore? Yeah, I just missed it today. But I want to show you a cool feature that is actually pretty awesome about Premiere. Remember how I did the multicam full tutorial walkthrough? Maybe you didn't watch it, but talked about how I use Pluralize and I have to export an XML, bring it into Pluralize, do the whole sync, bring it back in, do the awesome thing about Premiere Pro. Pluralize, the actual program, is built in. So what's awesome is if you have any sequence open, no matter what it is, and you want it to sync up, you literally can just go to Window, Extensions, Pluralize 4. It opens right up in its own window and is ready to rock and roll. And you literally just hit Synchronize. And it's like magic. Sync complete. Look, it all synced up. Pretty awesome. See, it's just like such a cool program with so many little things built in. And this is at my main editing workspace. I told you about I love customization. And this is what I love about it because I like to have the big huge window there for what my timeline is. Smaller window here for the preview. I have the thumbnail version of all the stuff here, but then I have the actual list view over here so I can bring those to there. And it's just, I like it. I like to do it the way I like. Am I weird? Yes. Am I indecisive? Yes. Do I go back and forth every single day? Absolutely. Okay, got to make a quick run to the Apple Store. I actually have to return. Maybe you've been seeing that I've been using this smart keyboard, the Apple Smart Keyboard. I really like it. It's nice. I just don't like the fact that the back's not covered. And for $170, it seems like it's kind of pricey to only cover the front. But I got this other case, which I really like. I know this seems like we just suddenly jumped into like a tech review, but I got this Zag keyboard case thing for the iPad Pro. This is the 10.5-inch iPad, and I really like this one because it has the keyboard on it, which I really like, and it can go at any angle when you're actually using it, which is sweet. It's like magnetic, so you can like set it at any angle, which I love. And it also has a built-in Apple Pencil holder, which is fantastic. And then the best feature of all, this thing just pops out, magnetic. Then we got a case for the iPad. See, I love that. See, as much as I love my computer, I've actually been using my iPad a ton and I'm trying to use my iPad for more and more and more. Outside of the obviously the video editing with like Premiere and Final Cut, I've been using my iPad for almost everything else because I have the LTE version of it and you don't realize how insanely convenient it is to have LTE built in an iPad until you have it. I've had it for like the last year and I love how easy it is for me to just go on the run and go to Starbucks or go to meetings and do all my note taking and use Tave and use all these different things that I use all the time. And just have it built in. I don't have to ever connect to Wi-Fi. I don't have to ever do anything like that. It just makes it so convenient and quick and easy. I'm trying to do more and more of only using my computer, specifically for like the intensive editing programs. The more and more I use the iPad, the more and more that I can see that obviously we're going to a very, very mobile device. And I don't think it's out of the question to think that in 5 years from now, like, all video editing entirely can be done on an iPad. Like, there'll be a really amazingly optimized Final Cut Pro for that, and the space will be 5 terabytes in the iPad, and I'm just excited for that, because if I could, like, lug around just a really small little iPad, it would be sweet. And I love this Apple Pencil. This just turned into, like, a full-on tech review of the Zag 10.5-inch keyboard. Link in the description. But I am gonna run to the Apple Store quick, so I'm gonna switch over to the smaller camera, the little RX100. I love this little camera every single time I vlog with it. It's just so nice. Let's switch over to this now. All right, we're good to go. Can you blow me kisses? I almost went to the store without bringing the things I'm actually going to return. I would have been pissed. It did get me thinking though, like, just how crazy it is that we live in such a, like, mobile driven world now. I would love to know, actually, this is like maybe your question of the day. How much time do you spend on a computer versus like your phone or an iPad or a tablet of some sort? I think it's intriguing now how many more of us are obviously spending tons of time on mobile devices. I just think it's just the convenience of how easy it is to use in comparison to bringing around a laptop. I'm curious to know, and I would love for you to post in the comments below, outside of, let's say, the main work you do, maybe 9 to 5, you work a job that obviously requires you to be on a computer, how much other time do you spend on an actual computer versus some sort of mobile device? For me personally, outside of me editing in Final Cut or Premiere or doing stuff in like Lightroom for photos, I don't use my laptop for anything else, like, at all anymore. You know, obviously I back up all my files to the computer and all that kind of stuff, but it's amazing how everything else I do now is mobile. Little did you know facts, I was actually part of the team that opened that store in 2007. I worked there for the first year it was open, and that was the same year the iPhone came out. That was revolutionary at that time, you know? All right, back again. Got 2 meetings tonight with 2 different brides, 7 to 7:45 and 7:45 to 8:30 or something right around there, but 2 back-to-back meetings. Haven't talked to these brides yet except for via email, so excited to get it going for you. And I figured I'll leave the camera running for a little bit and show you a little bit about how I talk with brides, because I know that that could be valuable for some of you people. I know that some of you are like introverts and you really don't love conversations with people you don't know. Other people like me, I love conversation and I'm not nervous going into any conversation. And a lot of the nerves I think that come from people are the lack of confidence in what you're doing. If you don't really believe in what you're selling, it's harder to sell it. If you get a bride on the phone, she's already pretty interested in what you're offering because you've got her on the phone, and that's a bigger step than email. So once you get them on the phone, it really should just be about building the relationship. Get to know them more. Ask more questions than you do give answers to things they're not asking. Don't jump right into the conversation telling them all about what you do well and what your company does well and what you do this and you do this. Get to know the couple. Break down the walls of nervousness even that they may have. Just talk to them. I always like to know how they got engaged, how long they've been together, how did they meet. Tell some unique things. Just get them talking. People love talking about themselves and talking in general. So get them doing that and it will break down the walls and make it much easier. What I like to do even before I have the conversation is just quickly go back through the notes. If you have some sort of system, I keep telling you about Tave, go back through the notes, go to previous emails that you guys have talked about, get some context, a little bit of context, unless it's been a really fresh lead that you just talked to and you remember everything about it. I really like to just quickly just bounce in the Tave and just see what we emailed about, because I may have asked her certain questions or she may have answered certain questions and she might be weirded out if I ask her the same question and she's like, well, did this guy listen or not? So I like to just go back in, look right away, get a feel for any conversations that we have had. This wedding is for February of 2018. So in this email I can see, we talked for a little bit. I told her the date was available. She actually lives in Memphis, Tennessee. I told her that I was jealous that I didn't live in Memphis because I love Tennessee a lot. So just a little context. So I'll start off just right away with that. Just talking a little bit about Tennessee. Ask her how long she's lived there, all that kind of stuff. So, all right, let's call her up. Hi, is this Emily? Hi, Emily. This is Scott from 4LC Studios. How are you? Awesome. Are you in Memphis right now or where are you at?
Oh, you just went down. Oh, that's awesome. What did you, so what brought you there?
So what do you actually do?
And how are you liking, have, did you spend any time in Memphis before then, or you just went out there for the job?
I love Nashville and Franklin and all those areas. I've been there so much, but I've spent a little bit of time in Memphis, but not nearly as much as the other parts of the state. But it's, I love that area. You're like, you sound just like me and my wife. That's that we, everything we did was super like, instant, like we were like, hey, it feels right, no need to delay. It just, that's so cool. Well, that went great. She seemed pretty confident. I like to feel like I have a pretty good sense as far as if I get someone on the phone, I have a very high success rate of booking, simply because if we've already gone through email communications and they're aware of pricing, they're aware of packaging, all I'm really talking with them about the phone is usually answering questions for them, like what is included in this package and what is a documentary film or what is this. It's usually not about, can you tell me why I should book you over somebody else? That phone call went really, really well. Super nice couple. And they want to book us, which is fantastic. February wedding is great because February is like the off season. So any additional work in the off season is great. So here's the beauty too, what I was telling you about Tave, and specifically I can do it all on the iPad. They said they wanted to book. We know what package they chose. All the information is already in Tave. I literally just formulate a contract. It automatically looks at all the stuff that's always in my contract. It automatically looks at their date, their venue location, their ceremony location, their names. Instantly creates a contract, sends an email to them, they can electronically sign the contract, and then they can pay right via the email, via credit card, and it sends me a thing back saying it was paid and shows the remaining balance. All automated. So once I make the contract, everything else just gets sent and does. It's just people. Tave's where it's at. I really should get paid by Tave to tell you about how great it is, but it just is. Awesome. Well, good to meet you guys. Appreciate you taking a few minutes. All right, you too. Bye-bye. Another great meeting. Super cool couple. That was actually a FaceTime meeting, which I try to have quite a bit because I like that. I get a chance to just see them and get a feel for whether something is surprising them when we're talking about it or they're just really digging the moment. Awesome. So I really like it. But hopefully this has been a little helpful to you. Just, I hope the biggest thing that's been helpful is just the fact that you need to be confident. You need to be confident in what you're selling. They believe when you're confident in what you're selling versus when you don't really believe it. What you have to remember in the wedding business is that this stuff is all expensive. The package that they're talking about that they're interested in doing is a $4,500 package. That's expensive to people. And you have to keep in mind that if it's expensive to people, they want to feel like you're confidently telling them that is a great package for them based on what they said, and that you're not kind of saying, well, we try to charge $4,000 for it, but we're willing to. I've always said I'm not a person that negotiates pricing, and it's not because there's arrogance of either paying me this or I'm not going to work for it. It's just what we've decided works for us. We don't take on 100 weddings a year. We only take on 30 to 35 weddings a year, and so we want to make sure that it's worth it for us, and we also feel like we are priced based on what we currently are offering. We've raised our prices every single year since we started, and we'll probably continue on that. And as we feel like we are worth more money, we will raise the prices according to that. But we feel confident in the pricing that we're at. Whenever I see people that are kind of really hesitant to talk costs and are kind of really flexible in pricing, what it usually means and what it usually shows other people is that you're not too confident in what you're actually charging, and you need to be confident. You need to be confident charging what you think you're worth. And if you get no bookings whatsoever, then maybe reconsider what your pricing is. Maybe it is too high. But for the most part, I think if you are booking 10 to 15% of all the leads that come in, you're at a pretty decent pricing structure. If you're booking 40 to 50% of leads that are coming in, or 60% of leads, don't say that's great because you're booking so many weddings. It means your prices are too cheap. You should not be landing 60 to 70% of leads that come in. And I know that may sound surprising to you, but I'm looking to land 10 to 15% of leads. If 10 people email me, one of them books me. That's the success rate that I'm really going for, because of the fact that I know that the pricing is going to be too high for many, but I don't need to book 60 to 70% of it. So evaluate that kind of stuff.
And all of those kind of things are things that I really track, and I spend a lot of time tracking to figure out like what my pricing should be next year and all those things. And that's the great thing about like something like Tave or some sort of business management software, client management software, is that all the leads at the end of the year, I can look at reports and get a feel for that. How many couples contacted me? How many did I book? What was my average price for the year? Where did the leads come from? Where do they keep coming from? Where do I need to spend money on advertising? Where should I not? It's really helpful to, if you analyze your business, that's how you grow. You don't just start getting more gigs by just kind of guessing where things are coming from. You have to have a game plan to get an idea as far as what your pricing should be and just charge it accordingly. If nothing happens, reevaluate your pricing. Or you may just want to reevaluate how you sell yourself, because you could have your pricing perfect, but if you're just not a good salesperson and you're not good at relationships, you just ain't gonna get gigs.